If you want to get quickly from one town to another, you take an express bus. If you want to make sure the bus will stop at your little street, you take a local bus. Well, with computers, it's sort of the same, but the opposite. If you want to move a little bit of data, say from your keyboard to the CPU, you use a host bus. If you want to move lots of data, speed along graphics or video to your monitor, you need a local bus. What am I talking about? You'll find out today as we explain local bus technology on this edition of the Computer Chronicles.
Computer Chronicles is brought to you in part by Intel, microprocessor technology for the software of today and tomorrow. Intel, the computer inside. Additional funding is provided by the Software Publishers Association, providers of educational materials to help manage software. Don't copy that floppy. And by Hewlett-Packard, Personal Computer Division.
Welcome to the Computer Chronicles. I'm Stuart Chaffee, and with me today is Bruce Gray of Megahertz Corporation.
Hello, Stuart.
Bruce, we're talking about expansion slots, expansion cards today. This is what we think of the big cards that would go in an ISA slot inside those big spaces in a desktop. One of the new standards for expansion is PCMCIA, and that's what you guys at Megahertz do. Run us through the advance in technology in PCMCIA cards.
Sure. Let me show you where we started. Early on in the industry, we were not able to get all the circuitry required for a modem onto the PC card, and we had to have this thing we call an external podule. Now, as technology progressed, we were able to take this circuitry and get it all on the card. Mm-hmm. We still had to contend with this cable, and that's very important to the laptop user because that's just an extra piece they have to carry. We're very proud of this innovation introduced last year. It's called X-Jack, and it is a retractable phone jack.
The whole thing is there, jack and all.
You can untether yourself from that cable.
Show us how it works.
Let me show you a little bit about how a person would install this. You slip the PC card into the drive bay.
Mm-hmm.
You close the drive bay door. You pop the X-Jack.
There you are. Just plug the phone
insert
in.
Insert your cable, and you're ready to
show
go.
Show that this really works, Bruce.
Sure.
So you're going to dial up some online service right now through that little modem card.
And the sound you hear, that is the modem dialing the phone, and then you'll hear this squelching sound, and that is the modem in your laptop mm-hmm. connecting with the modem you're calling on the other end. And our screen should be coming up here just...
And so we're online with that weather map.
We've tied into a weather service. And why this feature is so important to the laptop user is if you're ready to go back on the road, mm-hmm. you disconnect your cable, you close your top,
snap it in,
you retract your jack, and you're ready to go on the road.
All right, what's the next step you have over there, Bruce?
Okay, this is a product we just recently introduced. It is a cellular connect modem. It allows you to use a traditional phone line, or in a lot of cases, that phone line is not available and allows you to connect directly to your cellular phone.
So cell phone right into your little PCMCIA
That's correct.
Modem. Yeah. And we're not just talking about modem cards, right? You can do all kinds of things in PCMCIA.
Absolutely.
Slots.
You can get LAN cards, you can get storage cards, you can get memory cards, all in the PCMCIA.
An Ethernet card, for example, yeah.
All in the PCMCIA format.
Okay, today we look at different ways to enhance your computer by using expansion slots, whether they're PCMCIA, standard AT slots, or the new local bus technology. One of the terms you hear thrown around these days in discussions of local bus technology is plug and play. We're going to begin with a visit to Intel headquarters in Santa Clara, California, to find out about the benefits of plug-and-play and the new PCI local bus standard.
If you've had it with trying to figure out how to set the dip switches on your expansion cards, then plug-and-play may be for you. This latest innovation for Intel architecture-based PCs combines card-based software and hardware logic with new system-based configuration software. You just drop the card into the machine and it's ready to use. The catch is you'll need one of the new plug-and-play enabled computers.
And what they have in them is essentially is some updated software which does the algorithm to configure the cards automatically. And what it is there's some extensions at the low level, BIOS level, there's some extensions to the operating system, and there's actually a third level, which is like an application.
Plug-and-play computers will combine standard ISA bus expansion with the new PCI local bus.
You'll have both the new PCI local bus, which has much higher performance, but you'll also have ISA bus. That allows you to take advantage of all the huge installed base of ISA cards, some of which you may already own and have been using in your older PC. They will still work in your new personal computer.
Intel's ISA configuration software will let you program in those old ISA cards along with your new plug-and-play ISA or PCI local bus cards. Here's an example of three kinds of sound cards running programs on the same plug-and-play system.
The end user, it relieves frustration in adding your sound card, for example, and having to spend the whole Sunday afternoon determining what an IRQ is, what a DMA channel is, and what this jumper thing is anyway. So that will be eliminated with plug and play.
Plug and play enabled systems will be on dealer shelves in the summer of 94. For the Computer Chronicles, I'm Jonelle Patterson.
There are two standards out there for local bus technology, PCI and VESA, or the VL bus. Here to show us the benefits of both are Robert Gunn of Micronics and also Jeff Orr of Diamond Computer Systems. Robert, let's start with you. And first of all, a little basic history about expansion slot technology. And give us the story starting out with the ISA bus way back in the IBM AT days all the way up to PCI.
Sure. Sure. And as you might remember, the ISA bus was developed for the AT. And the AT computer consisted of a 286 microprocessor. The 286 microprocessor was a 16-bit microprocessor that operated 8 megahertz. Consequently, the ISA bus was a 16-bit, or is a 16-bit bus that operates at 8 megahertz. With the introduction of the 386 and the 486 microprocessors, which both are 32-bit microprocessors that operate at 33 megahertz, the bus became the bottleneck on getting data from the system board to the outside system. Therefore, Micronics was instrumental in developing the VESA local bus. What the VESA local bus is a 32-bit bus that operates at 33 megahertz. Hence, the CPU and the bus can communicate at the same speed.
All right, so you solve the bottleneck problem, real slow expansion bus over here compared to fast processor by getting the VL bus in there. Let's run a comparison now. You've got an old-fashioned ISA graphics card over there in that machine, and you have your VESA or VL graphics card over here. First of all, describe what's inside the machine over there in terms of that expansion card and the slots, Robert.
That is correct. We do have two identical machines here. These are both DX266 machines. This machine over here is equipped with a ISA graphics accelerator that occupies the ISA slot. And you can see here the two VL slots and the VL hard disk controller interface. What I'd like to do now is start this demo by kicking off the ISA machine and allowing it to load data from the hard drive into the main memory.
All right, let's go over here if we can get our shots of the second machine, and you tell me what's going on here, and I'll point and describe it, Robert. Right.
Again, this is, an identical DX266 machine. It also has a graphics accelerator in it, but you can see here the graphics accelerator occupies both the ISA slots in addition to the VESA slots. Sure, go ahead and start that machine.
All right, so I'll start this guy over here. Now, you're right. Pretty confident about this. You started your machine about 30 seconds ago. I just started the one with the VESA card in it. And again, tell me what we're loading here. What are we actually doing?
Great. What we're doing is from the DOS prompt, we went ahead and we're loading data from the hard disk onto main memory. And then we're going to run it into CorelDRAW. And so what we're doing is we're demonstrating the benefits of VESA both from a hard drive interface standpoint and also graphics acceleration.
All right, so we're booting up Windows, we're booting up CorelDRAW, and we're loading a graphic inside Corel on each of these two machines.
That is correct.
And even though I started this about a half a minute after you started your computer over there, this guy's almost done. And matter of fact, there's our motorcycle graphic. And
that's right.
The other guy's still cranking away,
still
crawling through the traffic jam in that slow ISA bus, huh?
That is correct.
All right, you've explained what the problems are, the bottleneck with the ISA bus, but we still see these buses on every new computer we buy today. Why?
Because of the fact that there are still some applications that don't require the speed that VESA offers. In addition, there's a large installed base of ISA peripherals still in the marketplace today.
All right, Robert, thank you very much. Let's go over here and join Jeff. How you doing?
Good.
All right, you guys at Diamond, you have accelerator cards, and you're going to show us a PCI card that goes into a PCI slot. First of all, explain the difference between PCI and what we just saw over there with Robert and the VESA or VL bus.
Sure. The biggest difference you'll find on PCI local bus compared to VESA local bus is processor independence. Processor independence means that as the processor technology increases, PCI will continue to improve its performance, where VL may flatten off.
So you say the VL technology over there was dependent on that 486 chip that it was working
with.
Yes,
certainly.
PCI, it doesn't care what processor it's working with?
It's not only made for the existing processor technology of 486s and Pentiums, but anything that could come after.
All right, go inside the box and show us the card and the slots and so on.
The first slot that you see here on the end is the standard AT bus slot. It has both the 8 and 16-bit portions. The three white slots adjacent to that are the PCI slots, the third one holding the Stealth32 PCI graphics accelerator that Diamond makes.
All right, Jeff, can you show me some practical examples of why I care about this speed if I'm not doing fancy things like high-end graphics and so on?
Well, you have a couple examples in just the standard Windows environment itself. The first would be word processing, the ability to manipulate text, whether it be highlighting, scrolling, and or editing text. You can see that it's very efficient if it's done with the graphics accelerator. The text can be highlighted, and you can go from beginning to end of document with very ease.
So even in a routine application like word processing, I still benefit from the speed. I can work faster.
Certainly. Other areas you can see that within Windows, just the generic application, is solitaire. For example,
very important application.
Here's a very already started game of solitaire. If we take a card and we drag it and let go of it, you can see how quickly and fluidly it moves across there. It's not jerky, and it takes very little time. The third example is just everyday operation of Windows, grabbing a window and moving it from place to place and seeing how quickly it updates. Without a graphics accelerator in your system, you'll find that the windows could actually be seen undrawing, and it doesn't act real world, and you can see in this case that they're happening real time.
All right, now the machine we were just running, or you're running over there right now, in fact has a Pentium processor in
it, correct.
But despite that, you can still speed things up, still get past that bus roadblock by using something like your accelerator card.
Absolutely. It doesn't really have too much effect if it's a 486 or a Pentium or another technology that comes beyond that. The acceleration is still there. It'll just be exponential.
Jeff, what's your advice to the user out there, to our viewer who wants to go out and buy a new computer and is a little confused about what these bus standards should be? Should they hold out for PCI, even though you can't buy very many PCI cards right now? Is Visa what you should go for? Are the ISA slots that Robert talked about good enough? Help our viewers.
At this point, it's going to really depend on what the purpose for that system will be, whether it's a first-time system or if they want to go to a full-blown Pentium system. Or the systems in between. It really has to do with the user's needs. Unfortunately, there's not necessarily a clear answer that I can provide you.
Are we going to have two standards going along the way, or are one of these guys going to beat out the other one?
You will see the standards that will continue to evolve all simultaneously.
Okay, confusion as usual. All right, while most of us use expansion slots for rather ordinary tasks like graphics acceleration or communications, some companies do rather exotic things with those little buses. One example is Trimble Navigation in Sunnyvale, California.
Trimble Navigation specializes in mobile GPS products that incorporate location into a variety of applications. Here, signals from the Global Positioning System satellite network track a car's progress on a digital map display. The GPS receiver is mounted on a PCMCIA card, which is inserted into a laptop computer. Trimble chose PCMCIA because of its growing acceptance in the mobile computing market.
So many of the computer manufacturers seem to be adopting that as a means to connect any variety of different accessories and peripherals to their machines. All the DOS machines and Apple is adopting the PCMCIA, so it really does enjoy as widespread acceptance by the various computer manufacturers as we've seen to date.
Before the advent of PCMCIA, most of Trimble's GPS receivers were straight serial devices. One advantage of PCMCIA is you get power off the PCMCIA slot, so there's no need for a separate power supply. That's a big advantage for portable field applications.
An interesting application, real-life application of GPS was in the Hurricane Andrew cleanup program, where we worked with IBM, the University of Florida, and again PennStuff, to put onto the IBM 710T pen-based tablet computer an application which allowed the disaster relief people to go out and very quickly locate damage, record attributes, and actually take digital pictures, just like you can date and timestamp images, you can position stamp images.
For the Computer Chronicles, I'm Jonelle Patterson.
In these days of multimedia computing, the most common use of an expansion slot is to add a soundboard, and the most demanding application is to move full motion video. Here to show us boards that do both are Kim Federico of Creative Labs and also Greg Millar of Radius. Kim, let's start with you, and we've been talking about fancy new things like PCI and VESA and PCMCIA, but your ISA slot is still good for a lot of things, and one of those is soundboards. Your guys' soundboards fit right into that ISA slot without a problem, right?
Right. Even with the most demanding sound applications today and the most state-of-the-art sound technology, the 16-bit ISA slot is still sufficient.
All right, go through just your board here and show us what's on that.
Okay, well, this is the SoundBlaster 16 SCSI 2, and the really nice thing about this card is that not only does it provide the 16-bit CD quality audio and music, but it also has a SCSI 2 interface, which will allow a user to connect, say, a CD-ROM drive or a hard disk straight to this card without requiring the use of another slot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk about the advantages of sound. And you have some demos here. I mean, we know sound is sort of fun and nice, but show us a couple examples where sound really does make a difference on your PC.
Right, it's getting very sophisticated these days.
Rookie 1 to TACCOM Control, request clearance for departure.
This is TACCOM Control, clearance granted. Is that you, kid?
Hack, good to hear you. So you're running your trials today. I wish I could be with you.
You shouldn't have any problems. Beggar's Canyon isn't half as tough as the runs we used to do. Good luck.
Thanks.
All right, so we have speech, we have sound effects, we have music. And without that, of course, this game wouldn't be the same game, right?
Right. This game, which was Rebel Assault by LucasArts, uses sound to the fullest extent, and you can probably imagine it would be like watching a silent movie if you didn't have the sound capabilities.
All right. How about some other examples, maybe more practical examples of where I can take advantage of sound inside my
computer? Well, we'll go into Windows here, and I'll give you an example of how sound can be used in a more business-oriented way. We've got a number of utilities that will allow you to create your own sounds. Something such as a MIDI sequencer will actually allow a user to compose music on their PC. And I'll give you a little sample of what it sounds like.
So you can use the sound not only to play back, but really to create sounds using your
That's
PC.
That's true.
All right, how about other stuff?
We also have things such as wave editors, which will allow you to manipulate wave files, and wave is the sound format mm-hmm. for Windows. So you can just create your own sound effects, or you could even create your own spoken voice for a business presentation.
Yeah, give me an example of that. I mean, one of the things we hear about is putting a sound file and appending it to a word processing document, just like you might scribble notes on a document.
Right. Well, that's a very popular use for sound in business today. We call it voice annotation. Uh-huh. And what you can do is record any voice,
this is a Microsoft Word document, and you've added sound files to it.
Mm-hmm.
So that in addition to reading
the... I can voice annotate a document in any application which supports OLE by using Sound OLE.
Okay, so lots of reasons to want to use one of those ISA slots to put sound on your machine.
Definitely.
All right, thanks a lot, Kim. Let's take a look at the real challenging process here, which is moving full motion video. Well, you've got a couple of examples here, first of all. Let me ask you first thing, Greg. We're looking at a Mac Quadra here. We've been looking at PCs up until now.
Right.
What's the difference in this whole expansion technology when we're dealing in the Mac world as opposed to the PC world?
Well, ever since the Mac 2, Apple's used a 32-bit bus. That's the new bus in the Macintosh. So all the cards that are built for those Mac 2 class machines have been new bus slots, which is pretty fast bus in and of itself, and it's been around almost 10 years now.
All right, now despite that, you guys have cards which still make things move even faster.
Exactly.
And show me what these two cards do.
This is a graphics card, and on the Macintosh, 24-bit graphics is what most people like to use for doing imaging applications.
Okay, and what performance benefit do you get out of this card?
With this card, you can move your images around on the screen about 30 times faster.
30 times faster by adding this kind of card. Okay, and what about this guy over here?
This is a much more sophisticated card. This is for doing live video. This does video in, out, compression, decompression.
Uh-huh. And what's this box you've got in the front here?
This is what attaches to this card. This allows you to do all your audio and video in and out of your machine.
Right. All right, give us some examples. You have two applications up here that will show us the advantage of the speed benefit you get by putting these cards in.
Exactly.
What's the first one?
This is Adobe Photoshop, an image retouching package.
Okay.
And you can see we have a 6 megabyte file up here on the screen. And with this card, you can very smoothly scroll around.
Which is not an easy thing to do.
No, right.
You can show us what it would be like without your board
without
in there?
Without it?
Well, that's what we're used to, yeah.
Okay, and that's over a 32-bit bus.
So even with the 32-bit bus, this is very demanding.
So that 30x factor you get by putting your card in
makes a big difference. I can really get some work done.
All right, that's an easy case. Now let's go to the tough one, which is full motion video.
Full motion video is like this, except 30 times a second.
Right.
Okay, so much tougher. We're going to show Adobe Premiere here.
Mm-hmm.
This, like Adobe Photoshop, edits images. This edits movies.
Okay. So you're going to load up Premiere. And this is the newest version of Premiere, which, as you say, is really a non-linear movie editor in a way, right?
Exactly. Now that you can digitize your movies, you can random access through them.
Okay,
it's not
so
like on tape.
So you're going to show me how you can actually edit a movie, but we don't have any videotape here. We're doing all this off the hard drive.
This is all off the machine.
All right, show me how you do this.
Okay. On the screen here, you can see there's several video clips here. Here's one of a roller coaster from the writer's point of view, and here from a spectator's point of view.
Uh-huh.
Okay, let's just see what that looks like. As we do, there's three effects on this: appeal, direct gone through, and a fade. Let's just put that right here, and that's the finished version of that. And in fact, you can see the random access. Here's part of the movie.
So you can jump to any frame in that movie without having to literally move through it as you would with tape.
Exactly.
Or film.
Now let's export it out to look like real video. This will play it out through the board.
And these would be examples of...
Here's the peel.
Here's a peel move you put in
and
there.
And fade back in.
And a fade.
So it's as simple as doing image editing, you can do movie editing now.
All right, there were sort of little baby examples, if you will, Greg. You can really do powerful high-end stuff using this card,
exactly.
Can't you?
The kinds of things that you see on television and sports mm-hmm. events, you can now do on your desktop machine. Let me show you a piece that someone did using a Macintosh, this card. Just actually a few weeks ago.
Okay, so the Mac, the card, and Adobe Premiere?
Premiere.
And you're rolling this piece
this
of video.
Is rolling now, off
well,
the
off
disk.
The hard drive, but a piece of video as it were. Let's
off
watch
the hard disk.
And
we're
listen,
reading a 500 megabyte file. All the tools in the Macintosh for doing text, for example, can be used in your video also.
Mm-hmm. Let's just watch this for a second. It's great. These are graphics created, say, in Photoshop, all the effects, all the moves
right.
done inside Premiere, all done on computer, really.
All done on computer, all digital.
All right, you say what, says 500 megabyte file
exactly.
for that two-minute clip, four-minute clip.
Mm-hmm. This is very hard to do traditionally on tape.
That's for sure. Compare for me the speed and the ability to do this kind of thing on this kind of Mac platform and the PCs we were seeing before.
For example, doing 24-bit graphics, most PCs are 8-bit graphics.
Right.
This is about 8 times faster than most PC graphics cards. Correspondingly, you really can't do this full motion video on a PC yet. That'll come.
Okay. Thanks a lot. That's our look at slots and buses. Stay tuned now for this week's computer news on Random Access.
In the Random Access file this week, Claris has announced plans to release 5 of its leading applications in native PowerPC form: Claris Impact, Claris Works 2.1, MacWrite Pro 1.5, FileMaker Pro, and Claris Draw will be recompiled for the PowerPC chip to take advantage of its speed and processing power. Meanwhile, IBM says it has already shipped more than 250,000 PowerPC 601 chips to computer manufacturers. Apple, so far, is the largest recipient, as it prepares for the introduction of the new Macintosh PowerPC models next month. Ambra, IBM's direct marketing subsidiary, has announced 2 new high-performance systems. The Lightning 100 is the first to feature IBM's Blue Lightning 100 MHz processor. It triples internal clock speed to outperform DX266 processors by over 10%. And the new 466 IVL offers an upgrade path from VESA to PCI and is Pentium Overdrive ready. LightSource Computer Images has started shipping a Windows version of its Ophoto color printing and scanning software, previously available on the Macintosh platform. Ophoto version 2 for Windows will operate on most popular flatbed desktop color scanners, and it will come bundled with the new Canon iX4015 color scanner. Galacticom has introduced version 6.2 of the major BBS, which offers a graphical user interface for bulletin board applications. Galacticom says this release makes it easier for companies and organizations to launch their own online services right out of the box. And if you're having trouble finding someone online, you might be interested in a new release from IDG Books. The 1994 Internet White Pages is the first printed directory of Internet users and their addresses. It includes a Hot Pages section with Internet addresses for corporate VIPs and journalists, and a listing of Internet service providers around the world. The Internet White Pages is available at computer bookstores for $29.95. That's it for this week's Computer Chronicles. I'm Janelle Stelson.